Lexus has finally introduced its first true three-row luxury crossover, the 2024 TX. But was it worth the wait? What's up, folks? I'm Dave Underkoffler, editor-in-chief of Autolist.com, a sister company to CarGurus. The TX is an all-new model from Lexus that fills a crucial hole in its lineup. It's larger than the highly popular RX and smaller than the more rugged GX and top-of-the-line LX. It's based on the Toyota Grand Highlander and comes in either gas, hybrid, or plug-in hybrid versions, with the price ranges going from $56,000 all the way up to $81,000. So is all that going to be enough to top rivals from Cadillac, Infiniti, Acura, Lincoln, and Genesis? Let's go spend some time with one and find out. But before we do, be sure to like and subscribe to this channel so you can get alerts on all of our future updates. All right, let's start by taking a look at the exterior of this TX. As I mentioned, it's based on the Toyota Grand Highlander, so you're gonna see a familiar shape on this vehicle as you walk around it. In the front, the look is a little anonymous for my taste. Lexus has a really nice design on the smaller RX. I wish they had copied a little bit more of that to this TX. As it stands right now, it's a little generic, a little bland, so that's a bit of a disappointment. You do have this chrome bar running across the front there. We also have daytime LED lights here. The model that we're testing is a 350, so that's a gas version with front-wheel drive and pretty much all of the options. So as you see it here, it's about $65,000. Turning to the side, you can really sort of see the boxy profile on this model compared to some of its rivals like the Acura MDX or the Genesis GV80. Compared to the MDX, this is about 5 inches longer overall, and that definitely pays dividends in terms of interior space. We'll talk about that a little bit later. As I mentioned, we're testing a loaded model with front-wheel drive, so we've got these optional 22-inch alloy wheels. I really like the looks of those. And there's not a lot of chrome on the rest of the vehicle. It's really more on the sportier side. You do have this chrome strip sort of running across the top, and then a little bit here on the mirror. Finally, at the back, it's again pretty simple back here. You do have this horizontal light bar. That's sort of a signature right now of a lot of other Lexus SUVs and crossovers. We have the Lexus badge, and then again, we're testing the 350 model. If you have an all-wheel drive version or maybe an F-Sport trim, you're gonna see badging for that back here as well. And if you're curious, the color of our tester is called Caviar, and it may not look like it right now, but in the sunlight, it's got a really nice metallic look to it. That's pretty cool. All right, under the hood of the 350 that we're testing is a 2.4-liter turbocharged four-cylinder engine. It makes 275 horsepower and 317 pound-feet of torque. It's hooked up to an 8-speed automatic transmission and has either front-wheel drive or optional all-wheel drive. It's rated by the EPA at 21 miles per gallon in the city, 27 on the highway, and 23 overall. If you opt for the all-wheel drive version, those city and highway ratings drop by 1 mile per gallon. Buyers looking for more power and fuel efficiency should consider the 500H. That uses this same engine plus an electric motor for 366 total horsepower and 406 pound-feet of torque. It's paired with a 6-speed automatic transmission and standard all-wheel drive. It's rated by the EPA at 27 miles per gallon in the city, 28 on the highway, and 27 overall. If that sounds like a great combination of power and efficiency, it will cost you though. The 500H starts at about $70,000. And then at the top of the TX lineup is the 550 Plus. That's a plug-in hybrid version that uses a 3.5-liter six-cylinder engine and an electric motor to make 404 total horsepower. It gives you a range of about 33 miles of all-electric driving, and it's rated by the EPA at 29 miles per gallon combined and 76 miles per gallon equivalent. All-wheel drive is standard on that model as well, and it's going to cost you, starting at about $79,000, including destination. So the TX gives you a lot of options in terms of gas, hybrid, or plug-in hybrid versions, but there is a price to pay depending on which one you choose. But what do you guys think? Which of those three models would you choose and what would you pay for it? Be sure to let us know in the comments below. Turning to the interior, generally this is a really cool interior. There's lots of practicality and comfort built in, although I do have some minor gripes. We'll get to those in a minute, but let's start with the good stuff. For one, this screen, it's a 14-inch touchscreen infotainment system. It has wireless Apple CarPlay and wireless Android Auto. Generally, the screen is set up really nice. There's one nitpick I have in that when you go to turn on CarPlay, it covers up this menu of buttons on the side. A lot of other systems will keep that anchored there, but otherwise, it's a clear screen. The menus and prompts are where you would expect them to be, so that's pretty nice. You also have climate control on the screen as well. A couple of things I like, you have these physical buttons for the temperature controls for driver and passenger. I like that those are not touch sensitive. You also have a physical volume knob. Again, I really like that. We're in a loaded luxury trim, so we have heated seats, cooled seats, a heated steering wheel. All of that's really nice. And then we also have a digital display for the instrument panel. That's configurable. It's really nice. You can adjust which information shows up there. And again, we're in the luxury trim, so we've got a heads-up display. And in addition to all that tech, there's really nice practicality built into this cabin. You've got a pair of cup holders here, and here's a nice little trick. If you don't need the cup holders, you can unlock them and pull them out. And then you have a much larger cubby space down here. That's pretty cool. I also like you've got a wireless smartphone charging pad here, and this whole thing slides out of the way, and there's sort of a secret cubby down below. I actually had this car for a few days before I even knew that was down there, so that's how secret it is. So that's nice. You have a trio of USB-C charge ports there, and then over here we've got more storage down below, and then you've got storage on the side of the door. So overall, lots of places to put things. In addition to that, the seats themselves, very comfortable. Our tester, we have sort of this fake suede on the side of these bolsters. The bolsters themselves are also comfortable. And then right here above the glove compartment is again sort of that soft suede-like material. That's a nice touch. But then you get to one of my biggest gripes about the cabin in this TX, and that's that there's just too much hard plastic throughout the cabin, especially on the lower half. These hard plastics are going to scratch really easily, they're going to age very quickly, and it's just not sort of the premium experience you expect from a Lexus. Maybe you'd see that on a Toyota, but I would hope that in this TX version they would have done something a little more high-end. Finally, two more things that I do like about this cabin. For one, we have a digital rearview mirror, so that's a nice bit of tech. And then this moonroof is absolutely enormous. I love the amount of light that it lets in. It's a really cool feature. All right, now let's take a look at the middle row of seats. And as I've mentioned earlier, one of the nice things about this TX is that there is space everywhere. And I really like just how accommodating it can be for taller adults. So if you've seen our videos before, you know the drill. I put the front seat to where I would have it if I were sitting up there. Basically, I'm sitting behind myself. Now this seat does slide fore and aft. I've got it all the way back. And in that setting, you can see I've got more than enough room for my legs, my feet. Headroom is great, and I really like that. Right now, the model that we're testing is a 7-passenger version. You can get captain's chairs in this middle row and make it a 6-seater. Sliding these seats is actually really easy. There's just a lever down here. You pull that up, and it slides forward. And that's nice if you're gonna have smaller kids in this seat and maybe adults back there. It gives them more room. I'll show you that in just a minute. It's also nice if you have car seats in these seats and you wanna move them closer to the adults up front. So all kinds of flexibility there. These seats also recline. So that's nice. And then there are plenty of amenities back here as well. We've got our own climate control system. And again, we're in a luxury trim. So we have 3-stage heated seats for these outboard seats. We also have a pair of USB-C charge ports down there and a little bit of a storage cubby. You've got sunshades here in the door. They're not power, but they are pretty handy in case you've got a little one that you want to nap back here. And then finally, a really nice armrest with a couple of cup holders. All right, now let's take a look at third row space. To get back there, there's a button on the top of each seat. You just push that, and the seat will move out of the way automatically. All right, now we're gonna move the seat back, and we're gonna start by having it all the way back. So this would be if you had 3 adults sitting in tandem. And as you can see, I do have space, a little bit of space for my knees and my feet. My head, if I sit up really tall, my head just barely grazes the top, but this is totally manageable to have 3 adults sitting like this. And again, this is with the middle seat all the way back. If you have somebody shorter in that seat, it's very easy to readjust. So say you've got a kid in the middle now, you have them there, and now I have plenty of room back here. I could spend a long time on a road trip, and that's pretty impressive. And then once you're back here, it's not really a penalty box that you might imagine. I've got features like a USB-C charge port here and on the other side. There's a speaker back here for myself. Plenty of storage. I've got a pair of cup holders and maybe a spot for your tablet or smartphone. And then these seats in the third row have a power recline. Finally, at the back, there's plenty of usable cargo space back here. This TX actually has more cargo space than the Genesis GV80, the Lincoln Aviator, or the Acura MDX. A couple of nice amenities back here. On our luxury trim, these seats are power folding, so that's pretty cool. You also have underneath the floor here, this is your cargo cover, but I really like that it stores under here when you're not using it, instead of in the garage and then it's not there when you actually need it. And then finally, built into this hatch are a pair of speakers, which is just a nice feature in case you're doing some tailgating back here. Next up, driving impressions. And one of my favorite things about the TX is the base engine in this 350 model that we're testing, the turbocharged 4-cylinder engine. 275 horsepower may not sound like enough for a big 3-row crossover like this, but in the real world, it's more than enough. You've got plenty of power, whether it's from a dead stop or you're on the freeway trying to pass somebody. There's really no turbo lag to speak of. Some other competitors are gonna have some of that. Not so in this Lexus, so I really like that. It's also paired really nicely with the 8-speed automatic transmission. It shifts when you want to, it doesn't shift when you don't want it to, so the entire powertrain on this car is pretty impressive. Another thing I really like and I've been impressed by in this TX is its turning radius. You can turn this car on a dime, whether it's a tight 3-point turn or getting in and out of a parking space. Yes, it's a long 3-row crossover, but it's really easy to maneuver and drive on a daily basis. That said, I do have a few gripes about how this TX drives, and the biggest one is the build quality and the ride quality. They just feel a little subpar considering this is a Lexus that can go up to $81,000. It feels a little too much like a Toyota and not enough like a Lexus, and that's just a little frustrating. Many of the competitors you're going to get in and feel very refined. This one is just lagging behind those competitors by a little bit. In terms of visibility, it's good but not great. It's good when you're looking straight out of the car, but when you look over my shoulder, this B-pillar is actually kind of thick. It can block a vehicle sitting in your blind spot. And then looking at the back, visibility is also a little tight, especially when all the seats are folded up and the headrests are sticking in the way. But overall, those gripes are pretty minor. They're certainly not deal breakers. I do think this TX is going to meet the needs and expectations of a lot of buyers. All right, folks, there you have it, our review of the first ever 2024 Lexus TX. Pros, well, it's got cavernous interior space. I really like the power from this base gas engine. And if that's not enough, there are hybrid and plug-in hybrid versions available. Cons, well, this front end styling is a little bland and anonymous. There's too much hard plastic in the interior, and the ride quality is a little too much Toyota and not quite enough Lexus. But overall, we do like this TX. We think it's a great addition to the Lexus crossover lineup. It's gonna suit the needs of a lot of buyers who are looking for a luxury experience and plenty of space mixed in. So if you are shopping for a three-row crossover, be sure to add this TX to your list. So for reviews or listings of this TX or anything else you're shopping for, new or used, be sure to check out cargurus.com. And before you go, like and subscribe to this channel so you can get alerts on all of our future updates. We'll see you out there.